All right, I'm ready to start wiring up the control room. And what I'm going to do is just follow my diagram. I'm going to start with where the wire comes in to the system. I've got my diagram kind of laid out here to follow. I'm just going to start where it comes in and start working my way around. The first thing is going to be these breakers and surge protection on the inlet. Here's my little bar that I'm going to mount them to. So I'll get that all wired up and I'll mount it up here in the corner and I'll just start following my diagram and start wiring it all up. Alright, so I wanted to go ahead and make my own bus bars. I want one for the positive and one for the negative. So I just bought a piece of brass bar and I'm going to cut it in half. I've got it all marked out here. I'm going to drill two holes on the end of each bar to anchor it to the wall, and then I'm going to drill and tap at least three and maybe up to five holes to connect terminals to. And so I'll actually drill them and tap them so I can screw right into this bus bar to secure them. Here's what I came up with to mount my bus bars. I went ahead and I drilled them 5/16 and tapped them. And to mount them, I wanted them to be completely isolated. And so what I did is I just clamped a piece of rubber on both ends of them and then secured it between two pieces of wood. And so I've made a little bit more progress here. I've got in my breakers and now I'm just running the wires, you know, to the bus bar and to the breakers. Pretty much done except wiring up the BMS and the AC panel. And so now I'm going to show you something on the BMS here. So the way this particular BMS came is it had two wires coming out of each side. This side is for the negative wire coming in. This is the negative wire going out. So they give you two wires and you can just combine them together. So I've already done that on this other side. I just crimped them both together with the hydraulic crimp on this lug here, and I'll do the same thing over here. And it's about an equivalent of about a 2-gauge wire. It's pretty heavy duty. If you use this heavier gauge wire, you will need a hydraulic clamp to get these lugs clamped on. Pretty much anything heavier than probably 8-gauge, you're going to want to buy a little hydraulic crimper. Just too much to do by hand. This is able to put tons of force on it to crimp that connection properly and get it good and tight. I've got about as far along with the system as I'm going to be able to make it on this trip, except for hooking up the AC side, which I'll do here in just a minute. But on the DC side, I'm not going to be able to go all the way to the batteries. I don't want to do the batteries yet because the batteries have power in them and I'm not ready to power up the system. As soon as I connect it to the batteries, you know, the system would be live. So I'm going to wait on the batteries, but I do have the BMS connected. The next thing we'll do once I get the batteries in is I will bring down a positive wire from here. It'll be a number 2-gauge, so a big heavy-duty wire will be going down to the batteries from this bus bar. And then the negative will be coming off of the other side of the BMS there. And that'll also be a number 2-gauge wire connecting to the negative terminal of the batteries. And then coming down out of the bottom of the BMS here will be all of the individual lines, wires that go to each cell of the battery to monitor the at a cell level. So one thing I will do, I've just got to go to Lowe's tonight and get some more bolts, but these bolts right here are just holding it in place and I didn't have the right length. So go to Lowe's tonight, I'll get some nice shorter bolts that I can screw in tight, but I just have these to kind of hold the wires in place while I'm working on it today. So I was starting to work on connecting the AC distribution box to the inverter. And so I took off this little panel here and I noticed that on the back side of it, there's several of these little rings that are missing. There's two of them that were missing, which meant that they must have fallen inside the inverter. So I had to take the front cover off and start looking for them. And it took a little doing, got the wife in here to help me out, and we found them. But it's a bit of a pain, just didn't want to leave anything in there that, you know, could make a contact across two points or something. So fortunately, we were able to find it and get it out. Just finishing up the wiring. Last night I took some time and clipped all the wires into place, kind of got them organized where you can see where everything runs at a glance. I like it all neat and tidy, and this is pretty much it for now. I'm going to be moving outside and connecting my solar panels to the roof. Yesterday we made the fateful trip to Santan Solar and bought our roof mounting rack system. That was exciting. It's about a 3-hour drive to Santan, but it's good to get those, and I'll be working on those today and then hopefully get some solar panels up in the next few days. So excited to start working on that. We do have a video series that explains how we design the system and how we source the components. So check that out if you're interested. All right, I have it all laid out here, put little marks at the bottom to show where my rails are going to go and where the end of the panels are going to be. And then here's the end of one panel and the beginning of the next panel. So I laid them all out, and I'll have enough room to put all the panels up, and then in the future, I'll have room for 6 more if I decide to expand the system.
So Red fixed up this ladder to use on the roof. I'm gonna staple some fabric on it so it doesn't scratch up the roof.
So unfortunately, they did not give us enough of these particular type of bolts that connect the two rails together. They give us 8 and should have given us 16. Instead of making the 6-hour round trip back to Santan to get some more, I'm going to have to modify a regular carriage bolt. And they're pretty close already. As you can see, they kind of have that little step, and it's all the right size. But this bulb here, this rounded part, is too big, and so I'm going to have to grind that, most of that off, down to about that level so it'll fit in the slot in the extruded aluminum. We're mounting the feet for the racks on the ridge of the pro panel in order to get the right clearance on the underside of the solar panels. The factory recommended 4 to 5 inches clearance between the back of the panel and the roof in order to get the proper ventilation. Also, being on top of the ridge, it'll be more likely to seal. So I have to make up several lengths of cable to connect my solar panels. And so to do that, I need to use some of this wire that I bought. This is 6 mm² wire, which is some of the heavier gauge wire. It's specially made for solar panels. It has several layers of insulation, has an outer layer that's UV resistant and acidic resistant, and then several other layers. So anyway, to go ahead and do that, I need to, first of all, strip off a little bit of the end of the wire. And this tool makes that really easy. It's fun to use. And I'm gonna put on this little connector. This is the male end. And it fits down just perfectly over this wire, just like that. And then I just need to crimp it on. And so I had to buy a special crimping tool that's made just for these connections. Just get it centered there. Need a lot of leverage because it's pretty hard to squeeze tight. And squeeze it until it closes all the way. All right, and then you have, it makes this nice kind of square pattern where it squishes together, and it's very well connected. And you just take off this end, slip it over the wire, slide that on until it stops, and then bring that nut back on. And that, and then they make these special little tools here that you can tighten it up with. So this one fits on that nut. This one slides down over here, and then you just tighten them up. And they snap whenever you get to the right tightness, which is kind of cool. And then you're done. And so now I have, this particular cable is a 12-foot length of cable, and I just have a few more of these to make, but pretty easy to make and actually kind of fun to do. The panels that we're using are 400-watt Trina panels. We went with the 400-watt size because we basically wanted to get the biggest we could buy, just because the bigger, the fewer panels that you have to put up to build your system, which means fewer connections, less hardware, just makes it easier. These are quite large panels. They're 80 inches by 40 inches, so that's about 6.5 feet tall by 3.5 feet wide, bigger than your front door. They're quite large. And so they went up really fast, and it was pretty easy to do. They're also split cell monocrystalline. Monocrystalline is a great style for the conditions that we have. So full sun in Arizona, monocrystalline works really well here. And they also have a special coating on them that makes them more, you know, resilient to direct sun and just helps them to last really well. I might also mention solar panel placing. So they recommend that you stay about 1.5 feet away from all the edges of the roof, just in order to keep the wind from trying to catch the edge of the solar panel. And so we came in about 2 feet from the one side and about 1.5 feet from the top and about 1 foot from the bottom. So we were able to maintain pretty good clearance all around from the edges of the roof. As far as the wiring here, I just followed my diagram. Basically, there's two strings going from the right side of the roof to the left. In the middle, they're connected together, positive to negative, with the fuse in between. And on the top and bottom, they just chain together and go towards the left side of the roof. So just followed the diagram and made the connections. The way the spacing of the panels worked out, they don't quite touch each other. The columns are about 6 inches apart. And it just worked out that way because of the way the spacing of the ridges on the pro panel themselves and how I had the feet mounted to the ridges. So I actually like having a little bit of space in between the columns. It actually gave me room to put my foot in there and reach when I needed to a few times. So it actually worked out pretty well. So before I install these components, I want to check continuity just to make sure that there's nothing wrong with them, because it'd be a huge pain to have to replace them later if there was something wrong with them. So I just set my voltmeter up, touch the probes to make sure that they make a noise. All right, we have continuity there. Okay, that all checks out.